What made you decide to rock the nasal strip back in the day? That was outstanding, my man.
Nasal strip, yeah, that was... I make my wallet a little bit bigger, but at the same time, actually it helped.
It's Unmuzzled with Nick Alberga.
What's going on, everybody, and welcome to episode 12 of Unmuzzled with yours truly, Nick Alberga, at the Golden Muzzy is where you can find me on Twitter. A reminder, subscribe wherever you get your podcast. It's been a lot of fun bringing this to you thus far. I'm so excited to bring on this week's guest. I think it worked out perfectly since he wore the number 12 in his illustrious NHL career. Two-time 50-goal scorer, over 1,000 games, over 500 goals, one of select players to do so. Clearly, he scored 5 goals in a game. This guy's resume is unbelievable. He's currently the managing director of the Capitals Alumni Association. That's right, Mr. Nasal Strip himself, Peter Bondra, is going to stop by in about 10 minutes from now. Suffice to say, you definitely don't want to miss that interview. First and foremost, I want to get to the latest news and notes making headlines around the NHL. How about Roman Josi, his extension, 8 years, over $72 million, well-deserved. But I think the keys in this contract are they full no trade, considering the organization and David Poile rarely gives those out, but he did to his captain, Roman Josi, and I get it. And he also becomes the third highest paid defenseman right now in the NHL behind Erik Karlsson and Drew Doughty. So make of it what you will. I feel like he's worth every penny. Don't forget the cap situation, or the tax situation, I should say, in Nashville as well. He probably could have got more elsewhere. But all in all, I don't have issue with this deal for a variety of reasons, and among them just the importance of Roman Josi to the Nashville Predators roster. Meantime, Vladimir Tarasenko will be out at least 5 months, and he'll be reevaluated in 5 months, which you start to wonder about this season running out of time for Vladimir Tarasenko. Underwent left shoulder surgery, successful at that, and again, he'll be reevaluated in 5 months. By my math, that puts him near the end of this season, and that's a tough, tough blow, clearly, for the St. Louis Blues, but if there's a team who can rally, considering what we saw last year from this organization, I think it's the St. Louis Blues. Through 10 games, Tarasenko had 3 goals, 7 assists. I look at a youngster like Robert Thomas to really step up, and I wonder what this means for Braden Schenn and Jaden Schwartz, but it has to be a collective stand-up by this team now, losing one of their top players in Vladimir Tarasenko. That's tough, and it was a harmless play, too, in the semi-collision with Sean Walker, defenseman for the Los Angeles Kings. You hate to see that, and it's certainly a shoulder that Tarasenko has had issue with in the past, so we wish him a speedy recovery, but he is not expected back anytime soon. You want to talk about weird injuries. Mason Appleton of the Winnipeg Jets, a team who is just in dire need of defensive help. They even, you know, got Lucas Pisa, if you can believe it. But he broke a bone in his foot playing football with his teammates. Of course, Winnipeg took part in the Heritage Classic. They were throwing the ball around a Mosaic Field. And next thing you know, one of their defensemen, young defenseman, breaks a bone in his foot trying to intercept a pass as teammates toss the ball around prior to practice. You can't make this shit up. Like, this is ridiculous. And I understand there's sort of people are calling for a summit on injury prevention in this NHL world. Some are avoidable, some are not. I have to put this on the spectrum of avoidable. Just be smarter about yourself. You're a guy trying to crack an NHL roster full-time, a team that needs defensemen, and you sustain an injury like this. I'm not a big fan of it, but again, players will be players. They'll have their fun. I think you just got to be smarter with putting yourself in situations that you could get injured. Granted, this is a freak injury, but just I thought really, really ridiculous how it all went down. This guy's getting set for an outdoor game, the Heritage Classic, doesn't play in it clearly, and breaks a bone in his foot, so he's going to miss some time, and hopefully he gets back up to snuff, certainly for a team who needs the depth right now, especially with Dustin Byfuglien not in that lineup. Another week, another costly injury for the Colorado Avalanche. This time it's their captain, Gabriel Landeskog. He'll be out indefinitely with a lower body injury. This after last week when Colorado lost Mikko Rantanen, so we'll see who needs to step up here. Clearly, a guy like Andrei Burakovsky might be thrusted into the top-line role here. JT Compher performed admirably so far with Rantanen down, but this is going to be heavy on the shoulders of Nathan MacKinnon, who has done it in the past, and we'll see if he can do it again here for Colorado. I got faith in this guy. I like Colorado in general. I think it's positive this team started off on the right foot, and I think every team deals with scrutiny and issues and injuries throughout a season. Right now, Colorado in tough times with two of their big guns out of the lineup, but I think they're going to stay afloat, and they've shown me a lot early in this season. I do think Colorado is the real deal. Lastly, I want to talk about a couple teams before I get to Peter Bondra. We'll start with the New York Islanders. Seven straight victories. Matthew Barzal has been on a different planet. Barry Trotz, again, continues to do an exceptional job. And if this continues, why not nominate him again for the Jack Adams Trophy? He's just done a brilliant, brilliant job with this team. You lose your captain, you lose your franchise. They have not skipped a beat. Stingy goaltending, stingy defensively. They're one of the best teams in this league, quite frankly, in my opinion right now. Semyon Varlamov and Thomas Greiss, the newest pairing, of course, Robin Leonard going to Chicago. Didn't work out with him re-signing with the Islanders, but they haven't missed a beat. They're playing excellent right now. Offense is a wonder for me going forward with this team, but when you're this stingy defensively, you're going to win a lot of hockey games, and I like the composition of that team, and I do think if he's not yet won, Matthew Barzal is really, really close to becoming a superstar in this league, so watch out for him. Meantime, John Tavares' new team, we know Tavares out of the lineup right now. They're really soft, and this is not breaking news by any stretch, but only compounded in the last week or so. Austin Matthews laid out by Brendan Dillon of the San Jose Sharks back on Friday. Jeff Petrie lights up Tyson Berry. I think Toronto needs to step up and answer the bell. And I'm not saying go out there and try to start a fight with everybody, but similar to Sidney Crosby a couple weeks ago, they got to start standing up for their teammates. Sidney Crosby, the captain, one of the best players on this planet for the Pittsburgh Penguins, steps up for a teammate who got decked a couple weeks back. And I'm just asking for this team to show a bit of character and a bit of resolve and say, you know, we're going to bite back, we're going to fight back, we're going to be nasty. A lot of the reasons why I think Toronto isn't successful very much in the Stanley Cup playoffs, especially against the Boston Bruins, who have all that in a bag when you look at their roster makeup. And that's all I'm asking for from Toronto, is just to show some bite and to show that they care. Not to say they don't care. But they rely heavily on skill, and there's no retribution. Like, if you're an opponent going against the Maple Leafs, why wouldn't you just continue to take liberties at their star guys because you know nobody else is coming back? Now, their argument can be, okay, we're going to get you on the power play. But their power play has been dreadful so far this season. You can't rely on, yeah, we think we're going to do this, and yeah, we have star power to do this. I think you got to bounce back, show some team toughness, and it goes a long way, I think, in that dressing room as well. That said, I think it's just about time to get to this week's interview. It's the man, the myth, the legend himself, the one and only number 12, Mr. Nasal Strip, Peter Bondra. Enjoy. This podcast is made possible by Derek Friesen, financial advisor at Edward Jones. For nearly 20 years now, he's helped service both the Burlington and Hamilton area. To review your outside investment portfolio for any financial questions, please call his office, 905-631-9929. That's 905-631-9929. Edward Jones, making sense of investing. Today's guest has a resume that will make the hairs on your upper lip tingle. Two-time 50-goal scorer, 37th player in NHL history to hit 500 goals, over 800 career points in nearly 1,200 career games. One of 37 players to score five or more goals in an NHL game. He enjoyed a fantastic 16-season NHL career, 14 of which were with his beloved Washington Capitals. This man made the nasal strip trendy. You know where I'm going with this. It's time to get unmuzzled with Peter Bondra. Bonsai, what's happening, buddy?
Not much, Nick. How are you?
Fantastic. Thanks so much for doing this and coming on the podcast, and I'll get it out of the way right away. What made you decide to rock the nasal strip back in the day? That was outstanding, my man.
Well, nasal strip, yeah, that was... I make my wallet a little bit bigger, but at the same time... actually, it helps. I really felt like that was a part of my equipment, and when you strip that on your nose, open up your nose, you can breathe a little bit better, and I felt that was just helping me. So I, even after sort of my deal expired, I still was wearing that thing, and I felt like that, like I said, when I was dressing up, that was just one of the routines from the trainers. They had to help me to place on the right spot of my nose.
That was brilliant, my man. You were born in 1968 in the Ukraine, then a part of the Soviet Union. When did you start playing hockey? How did that come to be?
Well, yeah, my story is a little bit different. Yeah, I was born in Russia. Russia at that time. But I really grew up in Czechoslovakia. Mm-hmm. I was 3 years old, but my parents moved back to Czechoslovakia, where they were originally from. And I grew up playing hockey since I was probably 8, 9 years old. My brother was the reason why. So he basically afternoon when my parents been at work. So they've been, he has to take care of me. So he took me to frozen ponds or frozen, little ponds around the area where I live. And so the old boys, they play hockey on this on the big service, and I was skating on the side pretty much every day. Then later on, I start I signed. Well, how did the time era works? Okay, that I remember we are in the second grade, so they took all second graders from the whole city to go skate on the ice. And there's a kind of coach and look at you. And I, at that time, I was a really good skater. So they select me to become part of the hockey school, which is, basically my when I grew up, my teammates are my classmates. So it was a good setup. The communism, what I grew up in, that was a great system, which is they provide everything for me as a player. They give me equipment. They we went to a school to pay for all the buses, all the trips. So, everything was well, just need to show a talent and you're part of the sort of group when you get better as a player. And then I really benefit from that.
I would say it worked out. The Capitals took you 156th overall, eighth round in a 1990 draft. What do you remember about your draft day? Like, you weren't there for the draft, right?
No, of course not. Okay. First of all, how I started. Okay. Yeah, I was drafted, I actually opened newspaper and Czechoslovakian newspaper, and I saw my name associated with the Washington Capitals. And really, I didn't have idea, actually, that I could even play in the National Hockey League. But maybe here, half a year prior to the draft, there was a big scout, Jack Button, very famous scout from Washington Capitals, and he was traveled to Eastern Europe like half a year before the draft, and he was scouting Richard Smehlik, which is he was playing in Czechoslovakian League. So my team play against Richard, and I knew about it. Jack Button's going to be at the game, and I told myself that before a game, maybe I got to show up in the game and make sure he noticed me. And I did. I scored a couple goals. So that Jack noticed me at the game, and he was supposed to leave next day, go back to his state, but decided to travel more east to see me play again. And that's how I got discovered by Jack Button. And so I met him first time. I remember today in the GM's office. And he asked me a question if I ever was thinking to play in the National Hockey League. Well, there was communism, so my right answer was not really, but if you somehow make that happen, I'm more than happy to try that NHL. So as you know, those days, there is no satellites, there is no internet. Barely, I never had a chance to see in the National Hockey League game in my eyes. So for me, just NHL, I knew a couple of players, obviously, Wayne Gretzky, maybe Paul Coffey, maybe Mario Lemieux. I kind of heard those names, but not really. I didn't know what NHL was. And for my days when I grew up in a communism regime, so the names like obviously Russian national team or Czechoslovakian team, that those are my sort of grew up heroes when I started playing hockey. So, yeah, that was a little bit unique. So, yeah, I learned from newspaper then I was drafted.
That's unbelievable. Among the feats in your career, I listed your resume. It's pretty damn epic. And, again, I'm with Peter Bondra. Take me back to February 5th, 1994. Your Capitals at home to face the Tampa Bay Lightning. I believe you're on the back end of a back-to-back after you're shut out by Patrick Waugh and the Montreal Canadiens. You had a career night. You were on a line with Dmitry Krstic and Dale Hunter. All you did was score five times in a 6-3 win. You're one of only 43 players in NHL history to do so. What do you remember about that night? You were just in the groove, weren't you?
Yeah, well, yes. If I shot from the locker room or from anywhere, the puck will go in. So I felt that way all game. But obviously, there's some good plays from Dima or Dale Hunter. I remember I scored shorthanded. I scored on the power play, 5-on-5, pretty much every situation. So that was a special night. And trust me, I always, you know, all the hockey guys, we are superstitious. So I try to go back to the same restaurant, have the same lunch before the game, what I had, but didn't work out. But yes, that was a special night. And, you know, just somehow everything went my way. And yes, there was 5 goals that night. It was one of the kind of memorable nights for me as in my hockey career.
Yeah, and the one thing I do appreciate about you is how modest you are. Like, you were the best, you know, one of the best goal scorers of my time watching the game at a young age. I was born in 1989, and you hit a feat that, again, it's hard to hit, and that's 500 career goals. You're a member of the Blackhawks, December 22nd, 2006. You put home a rebound off a point shot from Jason Cullimore against JSO Ben and the Toronto Maple Leafs. Describe that feeling to finally hit a mark that, you know, was very, very difficult for a kid, you know, at that time and early on before you're drafted, never thought he'd even play in the NHL.
Well, I'll tell you a story prior in my career. So, like, my first 3-4 years, I wasn't sure what type of player I was. So, really, I had more goals, more assists. But the lockout year, everything changed. Everything changed, which is we had a shorthanded season. And I did some crazy stuff. You know, obviously, we all hockey players, like I mentioned, we are superstitious. So I told myself, shorthanded season, I want to score 20 goals. So we play 40-plus games, so 20 goals will be a decent season, you know, for me, which is not established NHL player. But how I got to that 20 goals, I know that was my goal, individual goal, but obviously our goal was to win a Stanley Cup. But at the same time, if I do my job, obviously it will help the team to become dangerous in the playoffs. So what I did, I will share the story. So, you know those sticky pads?
Yeah.
When you have pretty much around your desk and in the offices. So I put number 20 on those pads pretty much everywhere, in the fridge, in the stall, in the locker room, in the alarm clock. Basically, every minute of the day, what I was I see that number 20. That number 20 remind me from the beginning just to work hard, make sure I do a little extra, make sure I sleep right, eat right. So make sure I'm prepared for the game, and nothing's going to stop me to score those 20 goals. When you put your thoughts and you put the work into it, everything is possible. So the season started, I start scoring the goals. So I put number 19, 18, and I obviously run the numbers. So, and become zero. And had a great year. I think that year I led the league in the goals, 34 in the shorthanded season, I believe. Yeah, that was short. Yeah. So that year really, I learned on myself, like if I put my mind and obviously need to be healthy and work hard and everything is possible. So the guy who, for me, coming from Eastern Europe, not established NHL player, all of a sudden led the league in the goals. So that sort of helped me, give me sort of good pathway to next seasons and become a goal scorer. Because, well, it's not easy to score goals. Trust me, you need to do a lot of stuff, obviously. And so also, you know, you can't be afraid to shoot the puck, and then you have to have a shot. And obviously, on the end of the day, you have to have a teammates around you. And I was fortunate to play with great centers like Mike Pavonka, Adam Oates, Andre Nikolishin. So I benefit from my teammates.
You mentioned your shot. It was one of the heaviest shots I've seen, especially in my time. What was the key? Like, how did you get so much torque on that stick, and how hard you shot the puck? Because it's one thing to shoot the puck, you know, shoot the puck fast, but it's another thing to shoot it hard. And I think you really had that hard shot.
Well, hard shot is not necessarily in the NHL. It's not necessarily has to be the hard shot, because if the goalie sees the shot, he's gonna get it. He's gonna stop it. I think that's more of a surprise or factor when you release the shot when the goalie doesn't expect to be shot coming, so it has to be quick. And same time, how I benefit from goals, obviously, when you have like Sergei Gonchar, I play a lot, we spend a lot of time together on the power play, and we practice a lot just to make sure the shot coming to proper side of my body, make sure I can release. And also on the end of the day, traffic on the front net will help, like, any case. So if the goalie doesn't see the shot, it's more easy to score goals. But, yeah, it comes with a lot of little things when you have to do. But at the same time, as a goal scorer, you need to have a confidence on your shot, on your ability. Because if I go to a game and I'm going to play against Martin Brodeur or Dominik Hasek, I can't think that they're best two goalies that ever play, maybe in national, arguably play in National Hockey League. So I don't need to change my shot, or I don't have to pick the corner. What I have to concentrate, make sure I shoot the puck with purpose and shoot before they know I will shoot. So I know it's kind of easy to say, but I think become more instinct for all the goal scorers, who've been scored a lot of goals in the National Hockey League.
Yeah, basically, you told me you taught Alex Ovechkin everything he knows. the first time you saw him, we were like, holy crap, like, you know, I had sort of something in my game similar. And in terms of the one-timers, because I think you're totally right, that's, you know, the big thing I do remember about you is how many one-timer goals you scored. And even when you look at Alex Ovechkin, especially on the power play, you know it's coming and the goalie still can't stop it, right?
Yes, of course. Well, this is now new technology coming to play. Obviously, Alex is a generational pure goal scorer, which is probably, it's arguably, you can tell, maybe one of kind in NHL history. Maybe two guys like him had to be goal scorers like him. But what I'm saying with Alex, the new technology, the stick, what he had, that whip on the stick, and the curve, what he has, it's just something when you put together, it's hard for even for goalie to read it. Even they know it's coming, but just it's coming so fast and so persist to a corner, to anywhere. So even you know it's coming, it's hard to stop, and that's a goal scorer. This is pure goal scorer, Alex Ovechkin.
It is. And do you ever sit there and even talk to your kids, and some of them play pro hockey right now, and wonder how many goals you could have scored in your NHL career with the technology now?
Well, not necessarily. All technology changing, but also goalies. They sort of more butterfly, they more mechanical, they cover more space. So, everything changed. So, obviously, I like the one thing now in the new game, which is it's open space to skate. Nobody can hold you. Nobody can grab you, lock you, twist you, punch you. It's like, for example, my days, we play against New Jersey Devils. You're lucky if the whole team going to get 18 to 20 shots. Now you're facing a trap in the neutral zone. On the top of that, they will defend the net. And now you have a goalie like Martin Brodeur. So, well, if you score two goals, well, there's a good chance you might tie the game or maybe even win the game, but you cannot give up any goals. So what I'm saying, yeah, the game changed, and obviously the speed is more there, the shots and everything else come with that. So it's hard. I mean, I'm not complaining, but I think that it's more exciting game right now to watch. And I'm a big fan of hockey. I watch a lot of hockey. So, you know, and talk about my kids, obviously, yeah, of course, we talk about after the game. I try to stay most of the time positive and just try to give them feedback, what they have to do and how they have to do. And make sure on the end of the day, whatever I'm telling them, make sure to have fun, because hockey should be fun.
It's a lot different. You were correct on that. And, you know, speaking of your career, most will remember you, of course, as a Washington Capital. But in your 14th season, I think we do forget sometimes it is a business. And often we're all guilty of not humanizing the situation. But you were known as a Washington Capitals. You were dealt to the Ottawa Senators. Take me back to that day where you found out the news and how truly difficult it was to swallow that deal to go to a different organization.
It was tough after 14 years. Obviously, you felt like I grew up here with my family. My family, sort of my kids, grew up in the Washington area, and all of a sudden, from overnight, and you are going somewhere else. I mean, as a hockey player, well, you know, first when I got the news from George, I was really upset. I tried to make sure nobody can see me. I'm trying to almost crying, or I felt like really sad. But at the same time, you shake it off and you look at even after a couple hours, I said, hey, it's the right move. Ottawa, there was one of the better teams in the league that time. I felt a new opportunity. So that was a business decision, and you know, you take like it is, and you just move on, and you know, it's hard to kind of put away 14 years, but like I said, there was business decision, and you just have, most of the players in the National Hockey League got traded once, twice, even more times, and you know, that happened to me first time, and was something new, but I thought I dealt okay with that, and just like I said, I've never been upset on Washington because if they traded me or something like that. That was just a business decision.
A couple more before I let you go, Pete. Just a couple quick hitters. You know, favorite line mates in the NHL, favorite city to play in, aside from Washington, clearly. And was there ever like a specific goalie you loved playing against because you just absolutely owned him?
I would say, okay, we'll start with my favorite city, New York. Obviously, Madison Square Garden, it's a special place. And especially some games where there was a circus a couple of days ago and you're coming in and all the smell. But the reason MSG, I scored a hat-trick my rookie year. So that place was always for me, not just because of history, what they had, but just it's a special place. New York was for me to play. The linemen, like, I like to play with Adam Oates or Mike Pivonka. Like, you know, those, especially Oates, he didn't shoot more often, so I was there for him. So Adam would probably be taking more proud to make assist empty netter than a score the goal himself. So that was kind of, you know, and those, when I play with Adam, you need to be ready to shoot all the time, and he will find you. So obviously Hall of Famer. So, what's the other one? What's the next?
Was there ever a goalie you love playing against because you just owned him?
I not necessarily owned, but Dominik Hasek. I had some success, but obviously he had a lot of success against me. But it's always something different, you know. And I remember to scoring one goal, and he wasn't happy. we had a 2-on-1 with Mike Pivonka, and I was kind of showing I'm going to pass to him. But he started cheating, so I hit him on the rib cage and went in, you know, from the bad angle. And he wasn't happy. And also, like, we had a little kind of sort of history of when you're in the playoffs. I'm not sure. There's some YouTube video when, obviously, our game plan was just to run him all the time. And we spent a lot of time on the crease and make his life sort of miserable. And I bumped him once in the corner. I didn't try to do anything, and just go after puck. And he had throw a catcher or blocker after me. Yeah, that was it was a good moment. Obviously, you know, we accomplished what he tried to accomplish. But yeah, to take Dominik Hasek off his game, it was a hard task for us.
Yeah, sounds about right. So you got to the Stanley Cup Final in 1998. Unfortunately, you ran into a dynasty known as the Detroit Red Wings, swept away. But the Capitals ended the drought back in 2018, as you very well know. What was it like, that experience, to, you know, spend the time with the Cup, the Stanley Cup Parade, and certainly a team you knew for a long, long time and still work for right now, the Washington Capitals, to finally prevail and Alex Ovechkin to get that Cup? What was that feeling like for you?
That was an unbelievable feeling. I felt like really relieved after 44 years of Capitals history. And obviously I was part of the 14 years we got close, but we didn't win it. And I felt for everybody, from all of my players of the Capitals, for myself, for everybody, just felt relief and felt a joy. There was just a good timing for Ovi and his group, and really I was proud to be part of that celebration. Obviously there was a lot of stuff happening with the organization, and it was really a great joy to be part of it.
You were awesome, my man. One more. Fatima, you met her in Abu Dhabi in 2016. I think, you know, often it's not talked about, you know, what alumni do for the community. And I monitor you a lot. You do a lot of great things for the community, and it's not publicized. But take the listener through how you met Fatima in Abu Dhabi in 2016 and how all that came together.
Well, yes, it came. Actually, this is part of my sort of work, what I do. I'm business development at Monumental Sports and Entertainment, and also I'm part of director of Alumni Association. And so this is my job. So I went to Abu Dhabi to play personally at a hockey tournament, which is six of us ex-NHL players. We went there, we fill up the local team, And I told one of the owners, I'm heading there, how I can help them, just to, you know, to help to do business, because our client, I'm not sure if I can mention him, but it's Etihad Airlines, which is they located in Abu Dhabi. So I said, well, I can do something in the area. I can do a hockey clinic and just make a general bus, you know, to the area. The Washington Capitals are there and we are here. So I went and I went through my playing the tournament. It was, everything went well. We still, I had a camera crew with me, a producer, a camera. We're still looking for something just to kind of from the region, make sure we can bring some footage. We want to show our sort of fans, different region, obviously different culture. And Fatima, she stepped on the ice and I was not too far from her. And she took a puck and started juggling that puck. And I asked her if I can record it, that video. And I asked her if I could put on the social media. She said, yes, yes. So talking to Fatima more, I find out she's a big hockey fan. She's a big hockey fan of Alex Ovechkin of Washington Capitals. She's got interesting story to tell, which is she's a hockey player. She's a referee. She's dedicated to hockey. And to have a, someone like her, which is with from no hockey region, in the middle, from Middle East, and be such a fan. So what we did, we as a group, Washington Capitals, and we invite her officially to coming to D.C. and meet Alex Ovechkin. So from this, through social media, we create so much, so great story, which is she has a lot of story to tell. On the end of the day, we got like 6-7 minutes on the nightly news, CNN, and all the major TV networks come and cover just that the meeting with Alex Ovechkin, Washington Capitals, and Fatima. So we create a business story, which is you know, a great success. And you know, it's just, we, you know, for a business, it's how I say it, it helps, and also help to our client, make sure they are staying with us for another few more years. And that's what it is. That's what we did. So I think that was a great story. I like Fatima. She's really dedicated hockey person, and she comes to DC pretty much every year from now on, and she's felt like she's our ambassador.
Amazing. You're tremendous, not only for that team and that community. And Peter, I'm so thankful for your time and sharing your stories and your wisdom of the game with me today. Appreciate it, man.
Well, thanks, Nick. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.